A PDF of additional material accompanies this program. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Right Kind of Wrong, The Science of Failing Well, by Amy C. Edmondson. Read by Kathe Mazur.
For Jack and Nick, with abiding love and growing admiration. I am not afraid of storms, for I'm learning how to sail my ship. Louisa May Alcott. Prologue. June, 1993. I'm sitting at the old wooden desk in my 15th floor office in William James Hall, where I'm a student in the new Harvard PhD program in organizational behavior. I lean in to look more closely at the small black and white screen on my bulky Apple computer. A stack of paper surveys I'd used to measure teamwork in two nearby hospitals sits pushed up against the wall at the edge of the desk. 6 months ago, hundreds of nurses and doctors had filled out those surveys, giving me a glimpse into how their teams were working. I've analyzed the data enough to learn that some of the teams were working together a whole lot better than others. Now, it's time for me to discover how many mistakes they've been making. In my hand, a small computer disk holds the long-awaited data on medication errors in each team, painstakingly collected by nurses over the past 6 months. All I need to do is run the statistical analysis to see if the team survey data correlate with the hospital's error data. This is the moment right before my first major research failure. Soon, I would find myself thinking, not for the first time, that maybe I wasn't cut out for a PhD program. I had been ambivalent about graduate school. I admired people who made meaningful contributions in the world without the leg up of an advanced degree. If you were smart and resourceful, it seemed to me, you should be able to carve out a unique path forward, doing work that made a difference in the world. But a decade after graduating from college, I'd had to admit defeat. True, much of that decade had been creative and, from certain vantages, enviable. I'd worked as chief engineer for Buckminster Fuller, the visionary inventor of the geodesic dome. After that, I made the shift from engineering to organizational development after a chance meeting with the founder of a consulting company and was soon fascinated by organizations and their failures. I worked with some of the oldest and largest companies in America. I met managers in the U.S. car industry in the late 1980s who saw that customers wanted fuel-efficient, high-quality cars, such as the new imports from Japan, but couldn't get their giant organizations to retool to make them. Everywhere I looked, thoughtful managers bemoaned their organization's inability to adapt to clear changes in what the world needed. I enjoyed the work immensely. My sense of defeat came from concluding that I'd gone as far as I could on my own steam. To be more effective in my new field of organizational behavior and management, I would have to go back to school. Then, perhaps, I could contribute in a meaningful way to the goal slowly taking shape in my mind: helping people and organizations learn so they can thrive in a world that keeps changing. I had no idea how to study this, nor how to contribute to changing how organizations worked. But it seemed like a problem worth solving. And I believed that I could learn from the professors in psychology and organizational behavior and somehow find a way to make a difference in understanding and altering the dynamics that make it hard for people and organizations to learn and thrive. Because of my interest in how organizations learn, as a brand new PhD student, I had been glad to accept the invitation to join a team of researchers studying medication errors at nearby Harvard Medical School. This ready-made project would help me learn how to conduct original research. Your first grade teacher probably told you that errors are a crucial source of learning, and medication errors, as anyone who has ever spent time in a hospital knows, are numerous and consequential. But suddenly, this did not seem an auspicious beginning to a research career. I had unequivocally failed to support my hypothesis. I had predicted that better teamwork would lead to fewer medication errors, measured by nurse investigators stopping in several times a week to review patient charts and talk to the nurses and doctors who worked there. Instead, the results were suggesting that better teams had higher, not lower, error rates. I was not just wrong. I was completely wrong. My hope of publishing a paper on my findings evaporated as I started to question again whether I could make it as a researcher. Most of us feel ashamed of our failures. We are more likely to hide them than to learn from them. Just because mistakes happen in organizations doesn't mean learning and improvement follow. Ashamed of being wrong, I felt afraid to tell my advisor. Within a few days, this surprise finding, this failure, would lead me gently to new insights, new data, and follow-up research projects that saved and changed the course of my academic career. I would publish a research paper from this first study called "Learning from Mistakes is Easier Said Than Done," a precursor to so much of my later work, and a theme that runs throughout my life's work and this book. I would also begin to understand how success as a researcher necessitates failure along the way. If you're not failing, you're not journeying into new territory. Since those early days, in the back of my mind, a more nuanced understanding of terms such as error and failure and mishap has taken shape. Now, I can share it with you. Introduction. Success is stumbling from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. Winston Churchill. The idea that people and organizations should learn from failure is popular and even seems obvious. But most of us fail to learn the valuable lessons failures can offer. We put off the hard work of reflecting on what we did wrong. Sometimes, we are reluctant to admit that we failed in the first place. We are embarrassed by our failures and quick to spot those of others. We deny, gloss over, and quickly move on from, or blame circumstances and other people for, things that go wrong. Every child learns, sooner or later, to dodge blame by pointing the finger elsewhere. Over time, this becomes habitual. Worse, these habits make us avoid stretch goals or challenges where we might fail. As a result, we lose out on countless opportunities to learn and develop new skills. This pernicious combination of human psychology, socialization, and institutional rewards makes mastering the science of failing well far more challenging than it needs to be. It's impossible to calculate the wasted time and resources created by our failure to learn from failure. It's just as hard to measure its emotional toll. Most of us go out of our way to avoid experiencing failure, robbing ourselves of adventure, accomplishment, and even love. This book is about what makes learning from failure so difficult to put into practice in our day-to-day lives and in the institutions we build. It's also about how we can do better. As you've already heard, I've not only studied mistakes and failures, I've experienced plenty of them myself and had to learn firsthand how to feel better about being so fallible. I've had more papers than I can count get rejected from top journals. I've had my car break down by the side of the road and spent a precarious night contemplating preventive maintenance. freshman year in college many years ago, I failed a first semester multivariable calculus exam. I've missed important Little League games and disappointed both of my sons. The list goes on and on. To come to terms with my shortcomings and to help others do the same, I decided to get scientific about it. I believe that part of successfully navigating failure to reap its rewards, and importantly, to avoid the wrong kinds of failure as often as possible, starts with understanding that not all failures are created equal. As you will see, some failures can rightly be called bad. Fortunately, most of these are also preventable. Other failures are genuinely good. They bring important discoveries that improve our lives and our world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.